Trusting in the word of life given in baptism, we're gathered in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. One with the communion of saints in all times and places, let us confess now our sin against God and one another. O God, our merciful Redeemer, we confess the ways we live only for ourselves. We fail to see you in our neighbor's face. We turn our ears from voices that cry out. We pass by the hungry and the oppressed. In your great mercy, forgive our sin and strengthen us for service to all the needy. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You are all children of the light and of the day. You are God's children now. In the mercy of God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. So with all the faithful in heaven and on earth, rejoice and be glad. Savior and Lord.
Amen. Though we do not know and cannot calculate the day of Christ's return, we live faithfully in the here and now as if we anticipate the day when we will be given eternal salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. A reading from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, the fifth chapter. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, the sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night, and those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build upon each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another.
Before the mountains were brought forth, or the land and the earth were born, from age to age you are God.
You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O children of earth.
For a thousand years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, like a watch in the night.
You sweep them away like a dream. They fade away suddenly, like the grass.
In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dry up and withered.
For we are consumed by your anger. We are afraid because of your wrath.
Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1. To each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant. You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have in abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless servant, throw him in the outer darkness, where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
You may be seated. The American writer Henry David Thoreau once wrote a story that retells the parable found in the gospel lesson that I just read. He writes, "Once there was a king who had 3 sons, each with a special talent. The first had a talent for growing fruit. the second for raising sheep, and the third for playing the violin. Well, one year the king had to go overseas on important business. So before departing, he called his three sons together and told them that he was depending on them to keep the people of the kingdom contented in his absence. Now for a while, things went well, but then came the winter, and it was a bitter and cruel winter. And right away, there was a severe shortage of firewood. So the first son was faced with a very difficult decision. Should he allow the people to cut down some of his beloved fruit trees for firewood? But when he saw the people shivering with cold, he finally allowed them to do so. The second son was also faced with a difficult decision. Food was starting to become very scarce. So should he allow the people to kill some of his beloved sheep for food? But when he saw the children crying for hunger, his heart went out to them, and he allowed them to kill some of the sheep. So the people had firewood for their fires and food for their tables. But nevertheless, the harsh winter continued to oppress them. So their spirits began to sag, and there was no one to cheer them up. So they turned to the fiddler, but he refused to play for them. And in the end, things got so bad that in desperation, many of them left to another country. And finally, one day, the king arrived back home. And he was terribly sad to find that many of his people had left his kingdom. So he called in his three sons to give an account of what went wrong. Well, the first said, "Father, I hope you won't be mad at me, but the winter was very cold, and so I allowed the people to cut down the fruit trees for firewood." And the second son said, "Father, I hope you won't be mad at me, but because of the food scarcity, I allowed the people to kill some of my sheep." But on hearing this, far from being angry, the father embraced his two sons and told them that he was very proud of them. Then the third son came, bored, carrying his fiddle with him. "Father," he said, "I refuse to play for the people because you weren't there to enjoy the music." "Well," then said the king, "play me a tune now, because my heart is full of sorrow." So the son raised his violin and bow, but found that his fingers had gone stiff from lack of exercise. No matter how hard he tried, he couldn't get them to move. Then the father said, "You could have cheered up the people with your music, but you refused. If the kingdom is half empty, the fault is yours. But now you can no longer play. That will be your punishment." Like the sons in this story, I believe that each of us have been given different resources and talents. And each of us has been entrusted to use these resources and talents to help care for the people in our Father's kingdom. This is the message of the parable that Jesus tells his disciples in today's gospel lesson. He tells it to them near the end of his ministry. Jesus had already entered into Jerusalem for the final time, with all the crowds cheering and waving their palms. But it was still a couple days before his betrayal and arrest. So today we find Jesus getting away from all the crowds and sitting on the Mount of Olives with his disciples, telling them about the final coming of the Son of Man, and teaching them a series of parables about what they were to do in the meantime, how they were to stay awake and be ready, and how they were to be good and trustworthy servants as they wait. And I guess that each of us also would long to hear those encouraging and comforting words from our Master. "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." But what does this mean for us today? How does this parable speak to our lives? I mean, what do we have to do to be called good and trustworthy? Does it simply mean that we hold on to all the correct theological beliefs, or maybe strictly obey a certain set of rules? Or maybe we just sit passively back and wait for God to come again? Actually, the parable doesn't even say it. But when the master leaves, he doesn't give his servants any clear instructions about what they're to do with the gifts that they've been given. He doesn't tell them to invest in this or to buy that or to do some other thing with the money. Instead, he leaves it up to each servant to decide. And those who were deemed good and trustworthy were those who took active responsibility for their gifts, those who took initiative and acted, those who stepped forward with God's gifts in hand and risked it all for the sake of God's kingdom. And the servant who was reprimanded and punished was the one who just buried the gift he was given, the one who was so scared or so lazy that he didn't even try. And I think this is why he was reprimanded and punished. Not because he failed, but because he didn't even attempt to succeed. He didn't step forward and take initiative and risk. Instead, he simply just played it safe and buried the gifts he'd been given. He didn't even try. How many times have we told our children that what counts is not whether we win or lose, but how we play the game? And I think this is a very Christian statement, one that we should always remember when we look at the gifts that we have. What counts is not whether we win or lose, but whether or not we even try to play the game. What counts is whether or not we dare to take a risk and the initiative to use those things that God has given us. What counts is whether or not we invest ourselves in God's kingdom and we take what we have and use it to do God's work. Whether we pass on the blessings we've received to those who hunger. Whether we share the good things that we've been given with those who thirst. Whether we seek to build community and to bring hope to the suffering and the outcast among us. And whether we reach out to those in need and show them the love of God, the love that God first showed us. You see, like the first disciples sitting on the Mount of Olives with Jesus, we too find ourselves waiting for the final coming of the Son of Man. And in the meantime, as we wait, we too are confronted by today's parable. We too are reminded of how God has generously and graciously gifted each one of us with a variety of talents and abilities and resources. And we too are challenged with the question, now what are you going to do? Will you step forward and take active responsibility for the gifts that you've been given? Will you take initiative and risk and invest yourself in God's kingdom? Or will you play it safe and bury the gifts you've been given and not even try? Make no mistake about it, these are challenging words. And this is a challenging parable. But thankfully, we do not have to face this challenge alone. Because you see, when we invest ourselves with God and in God's kingdom, we are investing in a mutual fund. Because God gives us companions. God gives us families and friends and support networks. God gives us the church. And God gives us the Holy Spirit. So that working together and guided and empowered by the Spirit, we can and we will meet the challenges that come our way. We can and we will step forward together with God's gifts in hand. We can and we will hear God proudly say to us, Well done, good and trustworthy servants. Enter into the joy of your master. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.